In the name of God, who was and is to come. Amen. Advent. We have come once again to a new year in the church's liturgical calendar and a new season. Advent takes its name from a Latin word meaning arrival or appearance. And in this season, the church would have us prepare to look both backward and forward. Back to the first coming of Christ as the babe born in Bethlehem, and forward to his coming again in glory at the end of all things. And here we are set in the middle, stretched between those two realities. The prayer that we call the collect of the day directly references both that first coming and what is still to come. Our gospel reading points us toward that unknowable time, the end time, the time of the hope for fulfillment of God's purposes. Despite this cruel emphasis in Advent, there are cues all around us, though, pushing us to focus on this season as a time to prepare to celebrate Christmas. Christmas with or without the Christ at its center. This is so even for many who would not count themselves as Christian believers, and yet still would observe a beautiful holiday. The thing is, exactly what a proper celebration of Christmas looks like is not immutable. It depends upon where we grew up and when. For me, this fact is underscored by a gift I've received at the start of each Advent for more years than I can count. Each year, a friend I've known since my very first day in seminary, 4 decades ago, that friend sends me a subscription to an interactive Advent calendar created by a team of English artists and computer animators. In the way of many Advent calendars, these annual offerings open up day by day some new depiction of a pre-holiday scene and an exposition of an Advent custom to go with a particular year's overall theme. This year, the theme is preparation for an Edwardian Christmas. And it seems to be about to take place in a house that looks suspiciously like a mini version of Downton Abbey. Another time it was an idealized Victorian Christmas. In some years, it's a modern holiday season in a particular part of England. While the religious significance of Advent is not entirely absent from these charming digital vignettes that come with this electronic Advent calendar, there is always a large dose of culture-bound nostalgia. Indeed, that is what makes these calendars interesting. Being an admitted Anglophile, I find it's fascinating to see how people in various times and places in England have prepared for Christmas during the season of Advent. I suspect that each of idea of what kind of preparations Advent or December at least is calling for, dictated by our assumptions of what a real Christmas celebration should include. These ideas come from many sources, from our immigrant forebears' places of origin, from our immediate family's traditions, from advertising, from literature and movies, from House and Home magazines, from how we've always done it here, or wish we'd always done it. The degree to which one might labor to make happen a so-called ideal Christmas of any description, I don't mean to tell you, it can be utterly exhausting. As we begin this Advent, it is well worth asking what would be most meaningful as we prepare to explore the depths of the Christ child's birth, the implications of the incarnation, the coming of God in the human flesh. It is worth remembering that all of that is more than a celebration of Christmas. They're all together, but I think it's worth our asking what's essential. It's also worth our asking, are we alone responsible for making the holiday that is ahead of us? At the same time, all this is going on, we have to contend with the fact that not all is as it should be in the world. We live in a time where menacing shadows seem to be gathering all around us. But Advent, at least, gives us permission to admit that all is not yet right in the world. There are days when the news from seemingly everywhere is so appalling that I find myself wishing, along with the prophet Isaiah, that God would rip open whatever it is that envelops the reality of this world, come down, or at least reach in and just fix it already. We have ample reason to long for a second arrival of Christ. Still, to speak of a second coming and the fulfillment of God's purposes as events to be desired is one thing, but the end of all things would be, well, the end of at least some things we do not feel ready to let go of. Thinking about this theme in Advent makes for an entirely comfortable time. How are we to prepare for the arrival of God's future when we do not know when it will appear, what it will be like, nor even whether we will like it? What makes Advent, this makes Advent a time to sit with our discomfort and wait for the gift of trust. Trust, which is another word for faith. Now, I'm speaking of Advent's two themes because I believe that with both of them, staying awake is important. All the waiting in Advent, all the call for preparation begins with paying attention. am certain this is not a call in accordance with sleepless nights. Rather, it is slow down, long enough, and often enough to be able to spot the things that really matter, or at least the things that are likely to be most needed. We need to claim the right and the space to distinguish between our ideas of an ideal celebration and a few important, really important things we might manage without overspending on money or energy. The preparations we devote ourselves to should be the ones that focus on what seems most nearly essential. When it comes to looking ahead to Christ's coming again, here too we need to slow down. Slow down enough to notice where the light of Christ might already be breaking into this shadow-ridden world. In the college for this day, we have already prayed for the grace to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Could it be that to put on the armor of light also means paying attention and staying alert to those places where Christ is already coming into the world's darkness in subtle and seemingly small ways? We don't have the timetable for the end, but we might spot the cracks through which bits of light already shine. If we need armor, it's not because we're called to fight a war by ourselves, but to bring in the kingdom of God in all its fullness. We need armor because we've been graciously invited only to participate in godly work. The real work, the big work of the Lord's done. And if we are to participate, we need spiritual protection. Each time we stop to notice goodness in the world, each time we stop to notice some expression of faith, hope, or love, we are made better able to fend off fear and despair and violent anger. And so, my hope with the start of this Advent season is that each of us might find in it the gentle peace and perspective that allows us to remain alert to the implications of Christ's first coming, and alert to the hope of his second